Your Excellencies. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. We're about to begin the program. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The program is about to begin.
Personnel and directional exit signs to a designated safe area. At this time, please take a brief moment to locate the exit closest to you. We thank you for your attention to this very important safety message.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our Master of Ceremonies, graciously standing in at the last moment as Juju Chang is sick with the flu. I am pleased to welcome award-winning television journalist for the BBC, Hard Talk Zone, Stephen Sakur.
Good morning. Good morning, Excellencies, Ministers, ladies and gentlemen. Please do take your seats, if you would, as this 50th anniversary ministerial meeting of the UNDP is now officially underway. So please take your seats, ladies and gentlemen. For those of you with good eyesight, you will already have appreciated that I am not Juju Chang. I am Stephen Sacker. I'm sorry to say Juju Chang, who was due to chair this opening session, is ill with the flu, and I'm very sorry about that, but I was very happy to stand in. Indeed, it's an honor and a privilege to be here with you today. So I'm going to guide you through this opening session. At least I am when you've all sat down and quietened down. Can I just please ask you, ladies and gentlemen, to take your seats right now? Because we really cannot begin until you do. Thank you very much. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we've got a lot to do this morning. We're going to think about the 50 years of UNDP programs, projects, and operations. We're going to try and learn lessons, and we're going to try and look to the future. We're going to try and share experience and ideas about what works and what doesn't work in development and poverty eradication, improving the lives of people around the world. And in that context, we've got some wonderful speakers this morning, and then we've got the breakout sessions a little bit later in the morning. The first thing we're going to do is hear from the UN Secretary General himself. He would love to have been here today. Unfortunately, he cannot be here. He's in the DRC, as many of you will know, but he did want to share some thoughts with all of us. So let us hear at the very beginning of our session from the UN SecGen.
Distinguished heads of state and government, Your Excellency Mr. Mogens, Lykketoft, President of the General Assembly, Excellencies, Ms. Helen Clark, UNDP Administrator and Chair of the United Nations Development Group, ladies and gentlemen, this year marks a milestone for development. The United Nations Development Program celebrates 50 years since its founding. For half a century, UNDP has been on the front lines of human need and aspiration. With its global presence and programmatic reach, UNDP has helped to combat poverty and to rebuild countries affected by crisis. With the pioneering analysis and forceful advocacy, UNDP has worked with the governments, civil society, and the private sector to build capable institutions and inclusive societies. And with a strong commitment to the most vulnerable members of society, UNDP has sought to empower people, especially women and girls. UNDP also plays a key coordinating role in the UN development system. This role will become even more important as we support national efforts to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. As we look to fulfill the great promise of the 2030 Agenda, I thank the UNDP family, past and present, for raising standards of living and advancing human well-being across the world. Thank you.
Thanks to Ban Ki-moon for that, and to add his own words of welcome. And I think the Secretary General laid out very well the context here of looking forward now to the Agenda 2030, the SDGs, and what the UNDP can do and will do to further those goals. With his own words of welcome and to lay out his vision of what we are going to achieve today, please give a very warm welcome to the President of the General Assembly, His Excellency Mogens Lykketoft.
Heads of State and Government, Honourable Ministers, Under Secretary General Helen Clark, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's an honour to welcome you to the General Assembly Hall to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the UN Development Programme. The advancement of social progress and better standards of life in larger freedom has been the core objective of the United Nations since it was founded some 70 years ago. And it is through the UNDP, the UN program established to address global poverty and exclusion, that member states have most explicitly sought to fulfill that objective. During its 50 years of history, UNDP, with the consistent support of development partners, has worked directly with developing countries across the world to save millions of people from lives in poverty and hunger. It is an organization that has grown with the United Nations, that has a geographical footprint that corresponds to our multipolar world, and a mandate that reflects the complexity of global challenges we face today. As we begin 15 years of concerted action to realize the Sustainable Development Goals, the task ahead of us is daunting. But success is possible if all of us play our part. Given its mandate, its function as resident coordinator at country level, its presence in over 170 of the world's poorest and most vulnerable countries as well, and in its role as chair of the UN Development Group, a dynamic UNDP will be and must be at the very heart of a dynamic response from the UN development system. Together, we must deliver as one, advocate loudly for Sustainable Development Goals action, work hand in hand with member states and other partners, and promote accountability for the last year's grand commitments. Ladies and gentlemen, as we celebrate the 50th birthday of UNDP, let us send a message of gratitude to all those who have worked and who continue to work so diligently in pursuit of the noble objectives of this organization. And let us vow to work together over the next 15 years to move forward the noble objectives to outstanding achievements for our people and our planet. I thank you and I congratulate the UNDP once again.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Now, a little bit of history for you. It is 50 years, of course, since the UNDP was created. Since then, the organization has made a contribution, a terrifically important contribution, all over the world. And we thought it was important just to take a glimpse of some of the achievements of UNDP over those 50 years, including just the perspectives that have been given by some of the UNDP's former administrators. So let's have a look at this video right now.
UNDP as we know it today began in 1966, building on a previous fund and a previous program of the UN for development. It was a different world. There were many very, very low income countries. Fast forward to where we are in 2016, we're within grasp in the next decade of seeing the number of low income countries fall hugely.
We started an organization called Women in Development. I was very interested in making sure that half of humanity was recognized aggressively. The other project that I felt very proud of was the Human Development Report. Mahbub el Haq had the vision of taking the data from all over the UN and pulling it together and comparing one nation to another.
I came from an environmental background and we were preaching sustainable development. So we sat down one day and we cooked up sustainable human development. as the mantra for our agency? And what about breathing life into this new concept and developing focus areas? What we emerged with was sort of a three-part area of focus: poverty, environment, and governance.
One has to start in terms of successes with the Millennium Development Goals. These MDGs became the central narrative of development and led to, you know, the extraordinary redeployment of debt relief, of government prioritized spending, as well as development resources behind these goals. And, you know, the results speak for themselves that, you know, uneven, yes, across the world, but more than a halving of portion of those living in poverty, and just huge development strides they did have by the end of a lot of buy-in from civil society and others, which probably were the biggest transformation that we were part of in my time.
One of the biggest successes was the disaster management part of the work, which in many countries allowed much less damage to take place after a natural disaster than 10, 20 years before that work was done. Of course, you can't prevent natural disasters, but what you can do is take measures ahead of time so people are ready, and when it happens, that people know what to do, how to protect themselves, how aid can be rushed in, and how things can be rapidly rebuilt.
There are so many actors in development. There are many more countries offering development cooperation today than there were in 1966. So it is a competitive world, and what's important is that we are always open to new partnerships. We always have to be at the cutting edge of what is it that the countries are asking for that reasonably UNDP should adapt to provide. The developing countries world will be characterized by middle income countries. Many will be upper middle income countries. UNDP as an organization has had to develop as countries have developed, and to change and improve and enhance the product and services that that offers. That's why we're still in business after 50 years, and that's how we will strive to stay relevant to developing countries as they continue their journey going forward.
So, ladies and gentlemen, that is where UNDP has been over the last 50 years. Of course, key to today is where is it going over the next 50 years? We heard there from a whole series of administrators of the UNDP, all of them on videotape. I'm delighted to say that we can now meet in the flesh the first woman to head the organization, host of this 50th anniversary ministerial meeting today. Please give a very warm welcome to the current UNDP administrator and chair of the UN Development Group, Helen Clark.
The General Assembly, presidents, prime ministers, ministers, excellency, and members of UNDP and the broader UN family who've joined us today. And it's a very great pleasure for me to welcome all of you to this 50th anniversary ministerial meeting for UNDP. It is truly a testament to the last half century of partnership that so many senior ministers and even heads of government and state have come all the way to New York to mark this very important milestone in the life of our organization. As you know, for 50 years, UNDP has been working on the front lines of development. It has advocated for change. It has connected countries to the knowledge, the experience, and the resources needed to help people build better lives. Of course, in half a century, the world has changed so much, and we have changed with it. But what has never changed is the core mission. The core mission of working with countries on the eradication of poverty, and these days with a new development agenda to do that in a way which also reduces inequality and exclusion and protects the planet on which we all depend. The Agenda 2030 and the Sustainable Development Goals, which were adopted by world leaders in this very General Assembly hall last September, are the framework for the next phase of UNDP's work with you. And now UNDP and the broader UN development system must work to advance the big, more complex, transformational sustainable development agenda. We've been working to see that UNDP is fit for purpose for this challenge. We have a more focused strategic plan. We have restructured ourselves, including by moving much more of our policy and program and other support for countries much closer to them in the regions. We've taken steps which have seen UNDP being ranked among the most transparent development organizations in the world. Indeed, in the last ranking, the most transparent. Yet we know that the ambition and the breadth and the depth of the new agenda will demand a lot more of us. We must be ever more proactive, responsive, innovative. And this is the reason we have invited you as very senior representatives of your country today. We wanted to engage ministers strategically on the key challenges before us and development. We want to hear your assessments of where we can be most helpful in support of your national development efforts and of the new Sustainable Development Goals implementation. So today, the discussions will focus on themes at the very heart of the new agenda and of UNDP's work and mandate in support of it. Those include, obviously, eradicating poverty and leaving nobody behind. What is going to drive the achievement of those important goals? How do we protect the planet at the same time as we sustain and advance growth and development? How do we help prevent violent conflict and build the more peaceful and inclusive societies? How do we support countries to manage the risks? There are always risks out there, but the way we manage them can help us to build our resilience to those risks. We invite you today to share the most ambitious vision you have for the new agenda and for how UNDP can support member states to move it forward. To move from agreement on the SDGs to action, UNDP must be part of helping deliver results. And we must build and keep the new partnerships and the old partnerships to tackle this agenda in challenging times. When the MDGs were launched, it was a time of reasonable growth and prosperity in the world economy. The SDGs are launched against a background of so much volatility, uncertainty, and complexity. But we know that if we work together, we can all rise to this task. So today's meeting is an invitation to you, our key stakeholders, to help shape our future as we strive to be relevant and responsive in the implementation of the new agenda. And the conclusions and recommendations you make to us will help guide our work as your partner and servant for years to come. Allow me once again to welcome you all very warmly to this very rare ministerial meeting for UNDP, celebrating a birthday, celebrating a half century of work, but also very forward-looking on what can be. And we look to you for the kind of discussion which will inspire us, inspire our executive board, and inspire us all to do the best we can to push sustainable development and the new agenda forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Madam Administrator. Now, it is, in a sense, a bit of a birthday party. No birthday party would be complete without a family photograph. Indeed, no international gathering such as this would be complete without a family photograph. So I'm going to ask for your kind cooperation and patience right now, because we have organized a family photo, and we think it's important because so many of you here are representing governments, either as head of government, senior minister, ambassador. It is so important to show what commitment there is around the world to the work of UNDP going forward. So we want to capture this moment with a photograph. It's going to be taken from the back of the General Assembly Hall. And what I would ask is that, Madam Administrator, you take a position just at the front of the stage. If you wouldn't mind, I could ask for the President of the General Assembly and the Associate Administrator of UNDP to join you, Madam Administrator, at the front, here at the front of the stage. And everybody else, if you would, I would ask you to stand up and turn around and give a great big cheesy grin to our photographer, whom you can see at the back of the hall. and we will capture this moment, a very important moment for UNDP. So everybody on your feet. Remember that grin. Photographer, do your best. So, 3, 2, 1, and smile. Excellent. Yay. I congratulate you, ladies and gentlemen. You're the most cooperative audience I've ever had. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you for that. Okay. Now, we're going to get to a substantive discussion right now. And we're going to hear some important first-hand experiences of what UNDP has done, what difference it has made around the world, and we're going to get the testimony of some wonderful and rather important people who are going to come up here on stage. Let me just give you, by way of introduction, some guidelines as well. It's fair to say that in the next half hour or so, and indeed in the breakout sessions that follow, we're going to hear from a very wide range and a large number of leaders, ministers, government leaders, who are going to share experiences of development, of poverty eradication, of the challenges that come with political leadership in countries that still face enormous challenge. And this is going to be different from your average UN meeting, or at least we certainly hope so. We want this to be about discussion, not prepared formal statements. We have said to all of our speakers that if they wish to place on the record longer statements, perhaps more detailed, of their experience and their positions, then that is very welcome, and those should be written down and presented on paper for the record. But in terms of the discussions we're going to have today, we want things to be much sharper, more spontaneous, and indeed more relaxed as well. So we're asking all participants to control themselves, to make sure that their opening remarks are no more, and I mean this, no more than 2 or 3 minutes long, because that means more people get a chance to talk, there can be more discussion, more question and answer, and less of the prepared statement. So please keep your remarks as short as you possibly can. Now, I know for some of you who've got important things to say, this seems like a challenge, but believe me, my job at the BBC on the Hard Talk show is to make sure sometimes that you guys in positions of leadership around the world answer questions, do not just provide the prepared speech. And that's what I'm going to do today, so I warn you now. I want lively, engaging discussion, and I'm sure you guys do too. So we're all going to do our best. Let me invite to the stage our first panel, and this is really to tease out some of the experiences that countries around the world have had of the UNDP's work, where it's worked, and maybe where it hasn't worked quite as well as well. So I'm going to call to the stage 6 participants. I'd like you to give them all a warm welcome. Of course, I don't want this to take too long, so I will introduce each one, and as they're making their way to the stage, give him a round of applause, and then I'll introduce the next one. So, please welcome onto the stage His Excellency, Mr. Faure Gnassingbé, who is President of Togo. Please give him a warm welcome. Next, let me invite onto the stage His Excellency, Mr. Rafael Pardo, Minister for Post-Conflict, Human Rights and Security in Colombia. Please welcome His Excellency Mr. Cevdet Yilmaz, Minister of Development from Turkey. A warm welcome, please, for Her Excellency Ms. Christina Persson, Minister for Strategic Development and Nordic Cooperation from Sweden. Applause. Next up, I'm delighted to welcome His Excellency Professor Ahsan Iqbal, Federal Minister for Planning, Development and Reform from Pakistan. And the final member of our six-member panel team, Her Excellency Dr. Sahar Nasser, Minister of International Cooperation from Egypt. Welcome, all of you. I have a microphone. I hope you all do too. And I hope for those ministers who are going to speak in home language, everybody, of course, has the translation facilities available. Now, this first session really is to lay out what UNDP, in conjunction with the work of your home governments, has achieved in the context of the commitment to poverty eradication, to improving the lives of the people in all of your countries. So I want to start with you, if I may, Mr. President, from the perspective of Togo. Talk to me and reflect with me on the 50 years of UNDP and 50 years of development programs in your country. How would you assess the achievements?
Ok, merci beaucoup. Je voudrais d'abord remercier Madame l'Administrateur Générale et toute la grande famille de PNUD de m'avoir invité pour ces 50 ans, ce 50e anniversaire du PNUD. Comme on nous a dit d'avoir un style direct et plutôt relax, je me permettrai de dire que la contribution du PNUD a été multiforme au Togo. Et je voudrais insister sur une période particulière de mon pays qui a été critique parce qu'elle correspondait à un processus de sortie de crise, puisque nous avons été sous sanctions pendant 15 ans, de 90 pratiquement à 2015. Et à partir de 2015, grâce au PNUD, nous avons initié un processus de sortie de crise dans une situation qui était très complexe, parce que c'était une crise à la fois politique, sociale et économique. Le PNUD avait l'avantage d'être resté de façon continue au Togo, donc avec une meilleure connaissance de la situation. C'est ainsi qu'avec les autres acteurs bilatéraux, elle a pu mettre cette connaissance au profit du dialogue politique dans notre pays pour que nous puissions au moins aller aux élections, puisqu'il fallait absolument que les dirigeants aient une certaine légitimité. Ça a été difficile, mais nous avons, grâce au PNUD, réussi à faire ces élections en 2007. Ensuite, le PNUD a consolidé cette paix retrouvée par le lancement d'un processus de réconciliation nationale qui a pour particularité d'associer la population à la base. C'est-à-dire qu'une consultation a été lancée au Togo en demandant aux hommes et aux femmes du Togo « Qu'est-ce que vous entendez par vérité ? » Est-ce que celui qui est au sud du Togo a la même compréhension du mot « vérité » que celui qui est au nord ? Vérité, justice et réconciliation. Donc ça nous a permis de dire que ce processus est beaucoup plus complexe que prévu parce que les différentes populations n'ont pas la même compréhension des objectifs que nous voulons atteindre. Donc grâce à cette consultation, nous avons évité les écueils et nous avons pu dérouler notre processus de réconciliation nationale. Ensuite, la preuve de la réussite de l'action du PNUD avec les autres partenaires, c'est que les élections qui se sont déroulées après ce processus de réconciliation ont toujours été apaisées et les deux dernières élections générales en 2013 et en 2015 ont eu lieu sur financement propre avec l'appui conseil du PNUD et ont été saluées par tous les observateurs. Nous avons acquis chemin faisant des capacités en matière de sécurité que nous avons pu partager avec d'autres pays de la sous-région. Pour ne pas être trop long, je dirais que la longue crise nous a mis en marge de la communauté de développement. Donc nous avons pris du retard dans l'exécution des objectifs du millénaire pour le développement. Mais grâce à la mobilisation et au plaidoyer du PNUD, nous avons pu rattraper le retard par un mécanisme d'accélération qui a été conçu et initié par le PNUD, ce qui nous a permis de nous mettre en bonne position pour les ODD. Et pour cette dernière partie des objectifs de développement durable, nous sommes en train de lancer deux programmes parce que nous avons constaté que la croissance dans notre pays n'était pas suffisamment inclusive. Donc il fallait une action volontaire, puisque les sources de notre croissance ne nous permettaient pas de faire profiter cette croissance-là aux populations les plus vulnérables. Nous avons lancé, avec l'aide du PNUD, mais aussi du pays frère du Sénégal, le programme d'urgence de développement communautaire. Nous venons de signer ce programme et nous pensons que cela va faire une différence parce que les populations les plus pauvres pourront avoir accès aux fruits de la croissance, pas de façon automatique, mais grâce à l'action volontariste de l'État. L'apport du PNUD dans ce domaine, c'est le mot urgence, c'est-à-dire que ce sont des procédures accélérées qui s'appuient sur des ressources nationales. Et ensuite, le deuxième programme que nous avons, la longue crise nous a privé des capacités administratives, des ressources humaines assez compétentes. Donc, avec le PNUD, nous étions partis sur la restauration de ces capacités-là, mais nous avons étendu le programme pour tenir compte des ODD. C'est-à-dire que maintenant, c'est un programme de renforcement de capacités de modernisation de l'État pour le développement durable, qui prend en compte les trois aspects, l'aspect économique, l'aspect social et l'aspect environnemental. Donc, je crois que je vais m'arrêter ici pour l'expérience togolaise. C'est pour simplement dire qu'à un moment critique de notre pays, nous avons vu que l'action du PNUD a fait la différence. Merci beaucoup.
Thanks, Mr. President. Just a very quick follow-up question, then I want to move along the panel. But, you know, we are gathered today in the context of a very, very big ambition. By 2030, according to the SDGs, poverty is going to be eradicated from the face of this earth. Now, you are the head of government in Togo, which still has a significant number of very poor people. Are you very confident that by 2030, there are going to be no people living in poverty in your country, or is this just another piece of UN rhetoric?
Merci beaucoup. Merci beaucoup. Non, je pense que ce qui est important, c'est l'ambition que nous nous fixons et les moyens que nous nous donnons. Et nous disons comment faire pour que l'échec du passé ne se répète pas. Et je crois que c'est cette ambition. Elle est d'autant plus importante que les conséquences de la pauvreté aujourd'hui sont beaucoup plus dévastatrices qu'elles étaient hier. Parce que le jeune qui est pauvre aujourd'hui a le choix entre sortir de la pauvreté ou alors un mauvais choix, le terrorisme, le trafic de drogue, et etc. Donc cela met plus de pression sur les gouvernements pour trouver les solutions idoines. C'est pour ça que nous n'avons pas de temps à perdre. J'ai parlé d'urgence. Agir maintenant, agir vite, et c'est ce que le programme d'urgence de développement communautaire nous permet de faire. Ne pas aller attendre des ressources venues de l'extérieur, mais mobiliser ce qu'on peut mobiliser sur le plan intérieur, adapter les procédures de passation des marchés pour que les populations puissent obtenir satisfaction. Maintenant, en 15 ans, vais-je éradiquer la pauvreté au Togo? Je pense que nous ferons des pas significatifs, parce que ce programme tient compte des besoins exprimés par les populations elles-mêmes. Les techniciens, les ministres sont allés sur le terrain en demandant aux populations qu'est-ce que vous voulez. Nous voulons de l'eau, nous voulons de l'électricité, mais nous avons priorisé. L'enveloppe est importante, mais le fait que ce programme ait été conçu avec la population de façon directe nous permet de nous concentrer sur ces objectifs-là.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Okay. Thank you. Let's go along the panel, and I'm delighted to see that already Mr. President obeyed my instructions and kept things nice and concise, and I'm hoping my panel members will continue to follow that trend. So let me ask you, if I may, Your Excellency Mr. Pardo, from the perspective, I was in Colombia recently for the BBC. There's a lot of hope in your country that you're going to emerge from many decades of conflict, and obviously we just heard from Togo that you have to put all of these issues of development and poverty eradication in the context of politics and political stability. So give us your perspective on where Colombia has come from and where you believe it's going in terms of its partnership with the UNDP and its efforts to improve the lives of its people.
Colombia tiene un conflicto desde antes del inicio de la Guerra Fría en América Latina. O sea, la existencia del grupo con el cual en semanas se va a hacer un acuerdo, en unas pocas semanas, que es entre el gobierno y las FARC, se originó en los años 50 en Colombia antes de la Revolución Cubana. Por lo tanto, el conflicto en Colombia lleva pues cinco décadas y estamos a semanas de cerrar ese capítulo. Es una situación histórica para el país y para el continente. Es el último conflicto que queda en las Américas. Por lo tanto, estamos a semanas de tener ese conflicto cerrado y en el pasado. De ahí queda un proceso muy importante que es construir la paz. Una cosa es hacer la paz, que va a ser muy pronto, pero construir la paz llevará años y años. Y tiene, pues por supuesto, una gran tarea que es integrar el país. Un conflicto de medio siglo ha dejado sectores de la sociedad y regiones muy atrasadas frente a otras regiones del país, frente a ciudades, frente a zonas que no han sufrido tanto el conflicto. El conflicto tiene realidades y imaginarios que generan marginalidades. Por lo tanto, los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible del PNUD, de las Naciones Unidas y globales, van a ser muy importantes para integrar las oportunidades en todo el territorio, en todo el territorio colombiano. Colombia tiene varias Colombias y lo que se pretende en el posconflicto es que haya un solo país integrado y que las regiones que han sufrido por la existencia del conflicto puedan estar con las mismas oportunidades que otras regiones del país.
Minister, I just want to, by the way, my linguistic skills are French, I can deal with Spanish just about, but if somebody could bring me a translation set, it would be helpful. But Minister, it seems to me that one of the issues today isn't just about absolute income levels, it's about equality. And Colombia is an interesting society because one of the great complaints of some of your people over the last 50 years has been of deep inequality, and that those, particularly in the countryside, the rural poor, have been left out of Colombia's development. So I just wonder whether you can reflect on that and whether you believe that the next 15 years, indeed the next 50 years, are going to see your government, future governments, concentrate on this issue of equality.
Ese, el tema de la desigualdad es uno de los temas centrales de nuestras sociedades hoy en día y es uno de los temas centrales que tiene que afrontar y resolver pues América Latina, que es uno de los continentes más desiguales que hay, y Colombia, que es uno de los países de mayor desigualdad dentro del continente. La desigualdad fundamental está entre el nivel de vida en las ciudades y el nivel de vida en las zonas rurales. Y el conflicto ha afectado muy negativamente a las personas que viven en zonas rurales. Por lo tanto, superar el conflicto, dejarlo atrás, va a permitir concentrarse en mejorar el nivel de vida en zonas rurales. Por ejemplo, la seguridad social en las ciudades grandes es tres veces más alta en la cobertura en seguridad social que en zonas rurales. Eso, esa brecha es lo que tenemos que buscar reducir o cerrar en los próximos 15 años. Por eso los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible son perfectamente compatibles con los objetivos de posconflicto que tiene Colombia en este momento.
All right, well, Minister, thank you very, very much for those remarks. Let us move along the panel now and move to Turkey, and we're delighted to have with us Minister from Turkey, Cevdet Yilmaz. And Mr. Yilmaz, Turkey's story over the last 50 years has been extraordinary. You know, you've been one of the fastest growing economies. You have developed your country, your economy in an extraordinary way, but you as we see on our television screens every night, you still have internal conflict. You now have enormous challenges in your region, which you are having to wrestle with. So it is an interesting moment for you to reflect on the achievements of the last 50 years. And of course, we're thinking in conjunction with the UNDP, but also how you see the focus for Turkey in the coming decades in terms of the development objectives of your government. So give us your thoughts on that.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Thank you for your soft talk, actually.
It can get harder, don't worry. It can definitely get harder.
Actually, at the outset, I'd like to congratulate UNDP and I wish happy birthday, 50 years of development effort, and we were all together in this process. The relation between UNDP and Turkey goes back to 1960s, at the very early days of the establishment of the organization. And through this period, as you have underlined, Turkey made great progress, actually, in development, particularly in the last 10, 15 years. And with this development in Turkey, our relations with UNDP also evolved, actually. Now we have more strategic relationship with UNDP. UNDP has its regional center in Istanbul, located in Istanbul. We work with UNDP not only for the programs related to Turkey, but we also work regionally, actually, share our experiences with UNDP and work together. We have programs, projects in third countries working together as UNDP and Turkey. And also we have a private center in Istanbul working for the role of private sector in development. So these examples are important to show how our relations evolved. And also I would like to appreciate the role of UNDP in refugee crisis. We live in a region in turmoil indeed, and especially the Syrian crisis is very critical, and it is getting more as a developmental problem for all of us, not only an humanitarian issue, but it is getting to be a developmental problem as well. And Turkey and UNDP are doing great job, actually, to provide some good examples how to help the education and health services, how to give training, how to organize labor market for these people and make them more on their foot and contribute to themselves and the host country.
Are you satisfied with the level of international support you are getting? Because Helen Clark did talk about one of the priorities of UNDP being more effective, better, faster crisis management. Yes. How would you assess the crisis management?
I am not satisfied at all, indeed. I mean,
well, that's funny, because a minute ago you said you were, but when you're being honest as opposed to tactful, you're not happy at all, aren't you?
Yes, we are not happy. Actually, looking at globally, the share of ODAs in the developed world is decreasing, actually. That may be related to the global crisis, but we should understand that we cannot come over the global crisis without helping others. By helping others, you also help yourselves, indeed, in the global level. And also in the crisis spots like Syria, unfortunately, the level of international help is not enough. The neighboring countries are sharing the burden, but we should understand that in terms of international law, as well as in terms of capacities of the neighboring countries, we should give a hand to the nations in the region to share their burden, actually. And without working together, we cannot solve these problems, actually. And in time, these problems will spread and affect all of us. We should be aware of this fact. I mean, we cannot just leave them to certain countries. I should also give a number to you. I mean, Turkey as an emerging donor is increasing its help to the world. In 2014, we have spent $3.5 billion as development aid to the world, and that corresponds to 0.5% of our GDP. It is above the average of DAC and close to UN target for the developed world. So I would like to call all our member countries to spend more effort, actually, to give more hand to others. And that is also requires in terms of SDGs. We have agreed on a very noble set of goals and principles. We know what needs to be done, but we have to focus on how we are going to do it and who is going to do it with what financial resources.
Well,
thank you very much.
Minister, that's a wonderful way of allowing me to seamlessly introduce our next minister, because I think it's fair to say none of us really look at Sweden and think, oh my goodness, there's a country that really desperately needs the help of the UNDP. We look at Sweden and think, oh my goodness, there's a country that can help fund the activities of the UNDP. I would think that we want to talk to you, if we may, Minister Persson, in the context of Sweden being a country that's always shown a major commitment to helping the programs of multilateral bodies like UNDP. But my question to you is, I guess, this, that we see in parts of Europe, at least, a growing sense of frustration that monies are put into overseas aid when some people in the home country think, you know what, we have problems at home, particularly with economic recession, with long-term Eurozone crisis, etc., etc. Do we really want and can we afford to keep funding all of these UN and other multilateral overseas projects? Do you worry about that when you reflect on 50 years of UNDP and look forward? Do you think Sweden is going to remain as committed and maybe become even more committed? Or is that politically becoming very difficult?
Sweden will definitely...
It is on. Okay.
Yeah, there you go. Yes.
Sweden will definitely remain committed to development aid and to close collaboration with the multilateral system and with UNDP. We have been, ever since the creation of UNDP in 1966, and we remain committed to giving 1% of GNI to official development assistance. We think this is important, more important than ever.
If I may so, you're more generous than almost any other country in Europe or indeed the rich world.
And we expect others to follow suit. And I expect others to realize that this lies in our self-interest.
But do you think they will? That's one of the questions.
That is another question.
Huh?
We are. I'm worried too. I'm worried for the nationalistic tendencies and the short-sightedness and the conservative backward thinking of large parts of the developed world, Europe, United States, and this is of course a big threat to multilateralism, to development, to peace and prosperity. But I guess
it's interesting what you just said, but for that frustration and discontent to be effectively managed, you have to be sure, and governments in the rich world have to be sure, that institutions like UNDP are using their resources incredibly efficiently and effectively, and that are working with governments in countries like Togo and many others, where those governments too are truly committed to poverty eradication in effective ways. Do you believe that effectiveness, that efficiency is there right now?
If the efficiency and the effectiveness was always there, we would have another world. It's a far from perfect world we are living in. And of course, this is a question of governance. It's a question of national governance, local governance, and global governance. And governments must be right on all levels in order to make sustainable development possible. And this is also part of the role the UNDP can play, to be a capacity builder, to be a policy advisor, to assist together with donors in the shaping of an efficient administration. Institutions is key to development. Without good institutions, you can never have sustainable development. And this is true for all countries. And we have a lot to share with one another, and we need to share, and we need to be partners in making the Agenda 2030 reality. We are just now starting the implementation of the agenda. And it is a fantastic achievement that we have decided on this visionary agenda. And what remains is the implementation, and that will be the tough part of it. But I'm very hopeful. I think we have come a long way of agreeing on this.
And through the UN organizations, and I'm in particular thinking of the UNDP, with the reporting, the assessment, and with the follow-up, and with the development of support, I think this will be possible. And I'm very hopeful for our own part in the rich world, and hopeful for also the developing countries that this will be possible.
Great. Well, we're going to grab on to your hope and optimism and hope that it's justified. And today is going to be very much about discussing the challenges and the difficulties as well as the opportunities. So thank you so much. Yeah.
Without hope, we wouldn't be here, would we?
Very true. Very true. And it has to be said, Sweden backs its hopes with real substantive help. So we thank you for your contribution. We're now going to go to a perspective from obviously a country with very different sets of challenges. So Ahsan Iqbal, welcome to you. We know Pakistan has enormous challenges, but in a sense, you know, you are a country, and I know it a little bit from having traveled through it several times, of enormous potential as well as enormous challenges. I just wonder, in the context of what we've just heard from the minister from Sweden, whether you come to today's milestone event with optimism and positivity in your heart or something a little darker.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to wish UNDP and everyone happy birthday on their 50th anniversary.
You know, when I turned 50, I wasn't feeling quite so brilliant about the number 50, but I guess this is a bit different.
With Pakistan, we have a long history of association between UNDP and Pakistan. And the question you asked me, that when I come here, I come with a lot of hope. From 2013 to 2016, in Pakistan, there is a journey of turnaround. We are making strides in facing the challenge of security. We are making strides in facing the challenge of energy. We are making strides in facing the challenges of inequality and economic progress. The country's indicators are improving, the law and order is improving, and energy situation is improving, and we want to build momentum on this path of recovery. In last 50 years, UNDP and Pakistan have been partners in number of strategic initiatives, starting from the birthplace. Pakistan was the birthplace of the idea of Human Development Index, which was started by Dr. Mehboob Alak, to today when we are working on number of policy issues like multidimensional poverty index with the help of UNDP, to democratic governance initiatives which are helping us improve the quality of public sector governance, because we think the key lies to achieving all the goals in improvement of the public sector administration and modernization of the civil service, because it is easy to set goals, but it is very difficult to achieve them unless there is a machine which will also move with the same ambition and with the same speed. So with UNDP, we are now involved in one of the most transformational civil service reform and public sector modernization agenda, which is, I think, gives me a lot of hope and promise for a future.
Do you ever feel that you are being lectured at by UN officials, people who come in from the outside and don't understand your particular problems?
Well, I have a very interesting story to say. I think
as long as it's short.
My experience is that the advantage of working with UNDP was that they always listened to us, and we were able to implement our priorities and our agendas. And that is the strength of UNDP, that it has zero political agenda, and I think that should be preserved and maintained. And I would also like to say that, you know, our coming here together is also a reflection that today the whole globe has a shared destiny. In today's world, you cannot have islands of peace and conflict, of prosperity and poverty, of health, well-being, and disease. So there has to be a global partnership to make our planet a safe place, and a place of sustainable development. I come from a country which emits 0.8% of global greenhouse gas emissions. But we are one of the top five most vulnerable countries for the climate change. And in the last 10 to 15 years, we have suffered from major natural calamities, whether they are floods, whether they are melting of glaciers, whether they are other disasters. And now we are having to build a very new capacity, infrastructure, and resilience within our communities. So I think there is also a need through UNDP to make developed world realize that because of their irresponsible development, there are millions of people today who are paying a big price. And they have a moral, social, and economic responsibility to help them. And that is where I would conclude that I think one important element for UNDP is to create strong, effective, knowledge-sharing platforms through which the global experience in development sector, which UNDP accumulates, that is shared by everyone and is available as best practices to all other countries.
Right. Well, that's a loud and clear message, and I'm sure people are taking note. Thank you, Minister, very much indeed. Let me thank you, Sahar Nasser, for being so patient, for waiting for your turn. I should say, I wish, as part of actually UNDP's 50th birthday, that our first panel were entirely gender equal. Of course, it's not quite, but maybe we're getting there, because at least it's sort of one third. Next time it'll be 50%. But Minister, thank you so much for joining us too. It's your turn really to reflect on 50 years of development in Egypt, the relationship that you forged with UNDP. I've already referred to the turbulence in your region, which presents particular challenges today. So when you're thinking about the future too, I wonder how much optimism you can bring with you today.
Thank you very much. It's lovely to be here, and congratulations to UNDP for their 50th anniversary. UNDP has been a strategic partner for Egypt over the past five decades, and it has played a pivotal role in several issues. And let me start with the gender, being an advocate for gender equality. And next time, I hope we have a more gender mainstream panel.
Well, I echo that, and also in our wider audience too. But we are what we are today, so give us your thoughts on that gender issue as well.
On gender, I think UNDP has played a pivotal role also in coordination with UN Women. You can see already the fruits reaped from such interventions, whether it's the economic empowerment, but let me also reflect on the latest parliamentary elections. It's a historical percentage, 15% of the current parliament is women, and that's really historical if you compare over the past decades. And that could be attributed largely to a lot of training and capacity building and mentoring throughout the years, and so it did pay off. So UNDP has played a real advocate on that. It has also been an impartial advisor, so I agree with my colleague. It's in fact, UNDP is seen as the face of the UN in Egypt and advocate on job creation. I'll focus on job creation. It has supported the issuance of the first microfinance law in Egypt, because that's one main instrument for poverty eradication. This law has been catering a lot of lagging regions where there is unemployment that is high, especially among youth. So that's a key milestone. Also on public works, UNDP has played a very important role in also coordinating with different donors who have been providing a lot of funding on that, which has provided jobs for unskilled women and men, but it also improved the quality of the communities in which they operate. It has also played a very key role on governance, on promoting good governance, transparency, level playing field, and that is really pivotal as the country moves into periods of transition. Access to data, access to timely information is critical when we're talking about democracy, when we're talking about rights. Even for policymakers, you need the timely and accurate data so that you put the right policies in hand, and that's something that we really appreciate. It has played a very important role in coordinating different donors. Egypt has been receiving funds from different IFIs, bilaterals, And the synergy is critical because you can only reach integrated solid solutions through an integrated program where we're all playing together as one team. And that's, I think, very important. And I want to also announced that today Egypt has launched its 2030 strategy in the presence and participation of the President Sisi, but also the participation of civil society, youth, the government, the private sector, because without ownership, leadership, and commitment, we will not be able to deliver on the SDGs.
And deliver, we're almost out of time, but delivery is so important. Egypt, I'm very aware, is a young country with a young population, and over the period to 2030, when you're supposed to be eliminating poverty, you're going to see your population rise quite dramatically. So you're, in a sense, going to have to answer the same question I asked the president of Togo, which is, to what extent can we take seriously the notion that by 2030, a country like Egypt can eliminate poverty?
Realizing this challenge, also taking stock that more than 50% of the population is youth, and taking into account the unemployment is highest among the young generation. So all the policy reforms, the economic reform program that the government has just launched and will be discussing with the parliament for endorsement in the coming few times, resonate around this. Because you cannot achieve sustainable and inclusive growth without job creation. We cannot achieve any reduction in poverty or shared economic prosperity without reaching out to the youth and making sure they are inclusive in the decision-making process. In fact, let me share with you another very important and significant figure. 14% of the new parliament are youth under the age of 35, and that's impressive. I've met with a large number of them, and you can see that they will play a very important role in the policy making and in monitoring the implementation of these policies, which is more important and more challenging.
Yeah, thank you. Minister, I really appreciate your comments. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, one of my jobs is... One of my jobs, which isn't the most pleasant task, but a rather important one, is to try to keep roughly to time. So much as I would love to actually ask the panel some more questions, because there are plenty more questions in my head, I'm afraid I've got to control my hard talk instincts, and at this point ask you to give all of our esteemed panelists a very warm thank you. Thank you, Your Excellencies, very much indeed. If I may invite you all now to take your seats again, thank you so much for coming and contributing like that. There are going to be, of course, more chances for discussion in the breakout sessions, which follow this session. So, Excellencies, thank you very much indeed. Please do take your seats back in the audience. And before this session closes, it is my pleasure now, please, Excellencies, thank you very much. It's my pleasure before we finish this morning, or at least this session this morning, to introduce to you all a figure that many of you will already know, that is the UNDP Associate Administrator, Tege Getu, who is going to introduce a short session on Agenda 2030. So welcome to him.
Thank you very much. We are lucky to be able to welcome the beginning of a new era. The first ever Universal Development Framework embodied by the 2030 Agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals. This ambitious agenda took years to craft. The result is a collective pledge to action for the well-being of all people and the protection of our planet. But agreeing on agenda is one thing. Implementing them is another. We need to begin translating plans into action. Indeed, across the world, governments are beginning to land the 2013 agenda. They are starting to align their national development plan with the new global targets. They are strengthening their capacity to work across the sectors in a coordinated way. creative public awareness campaigns are engaging citizens and helping to mobilize partnership. About 20 countries have volunteered to present their national plans at this year's high-level political forum on sustainable development. UNDP is prepared to do its part in supporting countries' efforts to implement the 2030 agenda. We are working closely with sister agencies to deliver effective and coherent support through a common framework called MAPS, which stands for Mainstreaming, Accelerating, and Policy Support. Our work in support of the 2030 agenda is aligned with UNDP's focus to help countries eradicate poverty, tackle inequalities, and promote peaceful and inclusive society. We will continue committed to empowering women and achieving gender equality. The video that we are about to see and I'm introducing show how UNDP plans to support countries in what seems to be a very daunting task. Through our past network and presence in 168 countries, we will help convene the diverse set of partners that are needed to get the job done. As mentioned in the video, UNDP can help connect the dots for people of the planet. That's why we are the trusted and neutral partners, and that's why we are also the lead coordinators for the effort. Thank you very much.
The plan to transform the world begins this year. The new 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development is a set of 17 global goals unanimously adopted by 193 governments. These Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs, aim to transform development into a universal aspiration to environmental, social, and economic progress. With more than 50 years of experience, UNDP is the largest development agency in the United Nations system. Our footprint covers some 170 countries and territories and is strengthened by our positive relationships with governments and citizens alike. UNDP is also the backbone and coordinator of the UN Development System. Together with other UN agencies and partners, we provide development services to member states that help them improve the lives of their citizens around the world. We simultaneously work to eradicate poverty and significantly reduce inequalities and exclusion. Our mission requires UNDP to help develop capacities for sustainable development, build resilience, and strengthen effective and democratic governance. Achieving these goals by 2030 can be a daunting and bewildering task, but we will help deliver this vast and ambitious agenda by working in and with countries through crisis, setbacks, and successes. UNDP supports the common approach identified by the whole UN Development Group to assist implementation of the SDGs. We will support mainstreaming the 2030 Agenda into national plans for sustainable development and acceleration of SDG progress targeting national priorities. Our skills and expertise will be made readily available to our partners. UNDP offers countries specialized policy support in areas of poverty and inequality, peaceful and just societies, and environment and health. We help countries access resources and funds critical to turn their commitments into tangible progress. UNDP supports countries to monitor progress, learn and apply lessons learned, and we connect people around the world to exchange knowledge, experience, and technologies. We can help organize a whole-of-society approach, building on our strengths to support the SDGs and bring diverse partners to the table. After all, investments yield greater returns when planned and delivered together. If the world is going to advance this new development agenda, we all need to work together to make progress. UNDP is here to connect the dots for both people and the planet.
Right. Well, thanks to Tege Getu, and there we go, connecting the dots between the people and the planet. It's all about now trying to make sense of
the 2030 agenda and in practical terms talk about how it's going to be implemented. And to that end, I'm going to tell you that our sort of formal opening session is pretty much coming to an end. But before it finally closes, I want to talk you through the rather important next phase of this 50th birthday UNDP event. We've got four breakout sessions that are going to start in, well, let's say at 25 past 11, so in 10 minutes from now. So you've got a little bit of time to get to the one that you choose. Let me talk you through the four choices you've got. Now, of course, I'm very biased because I'm hosting one of them, but I can tell you it's going to be really good. Eradicating poverty, leaving no one behind, moderated by a certain Stephen Sacker. That's going to be in conference room 6, and miss it at your peril. But if you choose one of the others, I understand there is a second session, protecting the planet, sustaining development. That one moderated by the South African TV host Natalie Becker. That's going to be in conference room 11. We then have Preventing Violent Conflict, Building Peaceful Societies, moderated by my BBC colleague, Matthew Price. Matthew's primed and ready to go, and he's going to be in conference room number 8. And the last one, the last session, Managing Risk, Building Resilience, that one moderated by Maria Luisa Rossi Hawkins of Mediaset, and it's in conference room number 12. So I invite you to exit the main assembly hall here through the doors on the sides of the auditorium. Take the elevator and the stairs down 2 floors to level 1B, where the 4 conference rooms are located, and volunteers will be on hand to tell you exactly where to go. So the sessions start at 11:25. I look forward to seeing you at my session, and then the plenary will begin again at 3 p.m. after lunch. Thank you very much for being here this morning. Thank you.